will be in April, and we'll be having Resurrection Sunday anyway. So there you go. Might as well get used to celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ every Sunday. It's a good thing to do. We're going to be back into our study, Love Never Fails. Go with me in 1 Corinthians. Go to chapter number 13. I'll start there here in a minute for an introduction. Pray for Dwayne and Teresa. They're traveling. They're down in Texas. Dwayne is speaking at a youth conference for an old friend of our church. And Bobby is away preaching out in some churches in Alabama. And it's good to have men and women who are faithful unto the Lord, who love to serve the King. And whether it's taking care of the soundboard or upstairs, or if someone's not able to be here, there's people that are faithfully step in and do a spirit-filled work of the Lord and in the Lord. And thank you for just a wonderful song and praise again. And thank you all for, hey, guess what? There's no competition today. There's no chief stuff or nothing like that, I heard. So there you go. We can be here extra time. What do you think? Okay. Don't do that to me. Don't say it. I think I heard Roger. Don't do it. We could be here for a while. Well, I'll see it too. Thank you all for praying for the old guy and his assorted just old bones thing. Many of you have different maladies, but the foot is feeling good. If I fall over, it's just normal right now. Nothing to be blamed. Arthritis in your body has a way of, just coming up. So we just keep on moving. Right, Milt? The best medicine is keep on moving. Don't. But, of course, I had to have it up for a number of days. I told you that last Sunday, and it is much better. And I thank the Lord for that, and thank you for praying. Thank you for many of you praying and interacting over that Facebook stuff. Cheryl told me that a number of people interacted. You know, it's a tough time of the year and the beginning of the year for us personally and our family, but thank you for that. And I always say often, I don't say it always, I say it often, all of you have different times of the year where loss strikes you and you're reminded of the goodness of God. All my life, you've been so faithful. All my life, you've been so good to me. And with every breath that I'm able, I will sing of the goodness of God. And every one of you, again, have suffered different loss at different times. But from what I understand in the Scripture, loss is okay. Loss is a good thing. And because on the other side of the loss is what we have in victory in the Lord Jesus Christ. And we just sung of those things in 1 Corinthians 15 and those verses, death, where is your sting? Grave, where is the victory? So we praise God. Thank you for that. Love never fails. I'll remind you that we were in this study quite a bit. We started, I think, this study in 2019. We're going to catch up now. None of you caught that. I've lost my... It wasn't very funny anyway. 1 Corinthians 13. Well, we started our series late summer, early fall, and we're going to continue to press on. There will be a few little hiccups in terms of special Sundays and special times, but we'll have a little bit of run, and we want to get ahead of ourselves. But we're in the second half of 1 Corinthians. We're in chapter number 9. I want to give you a little review of that in a little bit, but let me remind you of chapter number 13 and the theme behind our study, because this man Paul, the apostle, loves this church. He loves all the churches that he has planted, and it says in 1 Corinthians 13, verse number 4, charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity vaunteth not itself, is not puffed up. That charity love to give to someone without wanting anything in return, that grace love, that agape love, that love where it meets a need in benevolence when somebody's not looking for it, that's God's love for you and for me, that God so loved the world. We know that the Scriptures, when we do search out every time that, of course, love is mentioned so many times in Scripture, but when it ties together the same meaning of charity, it talks about greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, that you have a love one for another. He continues here in verse number 5 and says, doth not behave itself unseemly, which means charity. God's love here seeketh not her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in the truth. Verse number 7 and 8. Charity beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Where, by the way, our type of love fails, God's love never fails. Charity never faileth, as it says in verse number 8, our theme verse. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. All the things that are important to man will vanish away. They will not be important in view of, in light of, this beautiful love of God, this charity. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 9 as you're reminded of the essence and what's behind in the background of our study, how we studied, of course, Apostle Paul, how it ties together to the book of Acts, this church that was, of course, started on his second missionary journey. We know that Paul's gospel ministry also, too, was constantly plagued by Judaizers, and that's part of what happens in chapter number 9. In turn, he was put in a position where he often had to reestablish his authority and apostleship. You think of what he wrote in chapter number 13, chapter number 12 we'll get to here. All of them, he corrects them. In fact, he shows them, by the inspiration of God, what is profitable. He actually, in all of his words that he writes, says, hey, all scriptures given by inspiration of God is profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, instruction, and righteousness. That's what Paul's doing. And he's doing it with a heart of love. He's doing it with the gospel at the centerpiece of it, the hope, the good news of the gospel. And he's saying, hey, my ministry is God's ministry. It belongs to him. If you look at chapter number 9, verse number 1, this is where this Judaizer conflict comes. Some of them are saying, hey, there's more to this, and we're going to criticize you. We're going to bring more laws into the mix. We're going to mess with your calling from God. And Paul's saying, am I not an apostle? Verse number 1. Am I not free? Have I not seen Jesus our Lord? Are not ye my work in the Lord? Hey, church at Corinth, don't you know who I am? Don't you know how I love you? Don't you know that I have been called out by God to do this work? It says in verse number 2, if I be not an apostle unto others, yet doubtless I am to you, for the seal of mine apostleship are ye in the Lord. Hey, you are mine and I am yours, but most of all, we are his in Christ Jesus, and you are in him. But see, Paul's ministry was constantly plagued, his leadership, his authority. Even to cite 1 Thessalonians chapter number 4 up on the screen, it's a reminder of how his authority and the authority of the pastor and the church is supposed to be regarded. We beseech you, brethren, to know them which labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you and esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake and be at peace among yourselves. You should see some of these notes from when we were back in this back in December. This is a quick review. You see, Paul is telling them, you need to honor them through your support. Sometimes, and this part of it is going to become a financial matter to take care of the man of God, yes, and we broke that down, but in the essence of the honor of Paul and his apostleship, his church planting, he's quite a man of God. He is the guy that we saw in the first 14 verses of this chapter prove that he was proven, that he was legit, that his legitimacy was in the Word of God, in his relationship with Jesus, in the Spirit of God, that he was always a guy that sowed and reaped the fruit of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that he would always have the ability to make sense over matters and say, hey, this is the importance of the law. Jesus Christ fulfilled the law. So you need to just look at honoring the Lord. Honor me through your support of the ministry that I have here, because the ministry I have is of the Lord. Very simply put, when we looked at this a few weeks ago in this chapter, we saw the heart of this man truly say, look, you ought not to muzzle the mouth of the ox that treadeth out the corn. Doth not God take care for his oxen, as it says in verse number 9? He went further to say that, as the servant of Christ, you are, and I am, as the church, to see, okay, if this person who's the servant of Christ is called and anointed to be the pastor, we realize that they automatically have earned the honor from God's people. Because that person is God's man. Paul was putting himself in that place and saying, let me just get you to the point in this chapter, in this first half of this chapter, where again, what God does and how he aligns things, we are supposed to submit to his work, his plan, his direction, his path. And when we see Paul saying, hey, remember, I am the servant of Christ, and whenever God calls a servant of Christ, he puts him in that place. In fact, it says in 1 Timothy 5 that Paul instructed Timothy how to teach the church to properly honor the elders that rule well. This is the context of this chapter. This is us looking at, okay, how is it that the church is supposed to align, and how are they supposed to treat Paul, and how are they supposed to treat all the other leaders that are there for this church, how to treat the pastor. It means also on the other side of it, just gaining a bunch of knowledge, it can puff you up. But charity edifieth. So let's be careful. We know in chapter number 8, you don't want to be a stumbling block to an immature believer just because you have a handle on things. Paul said that to them and said, hey, that idol stuff and all those things, hey, an idol is nothing in the world, that there is none other God but one. So hey, I understand the meaning and the importance of the culture you live in, but remember, when you gain biblical knowledge, let's not be so much of a stumbling block that we do not do things right in the eyes of the Lord. In regards to the leadership of the church, I want you to understand what I'm doing, Paul's saying, to align you. See, in order to illustrate the Christian use of personal rights, Paul presented a twofold defense of his financial policy as a servant of Christ. Again, the first half was, hey, you got to get in things in order. This is the way it ought to be. You take care of the person that God's put in place. But now he's about to do something in the second half of this chapter to say, hey, I appreciate now that you're getting it right, and here's my heart as the apostle. I choose to refuse that because I'm a tent maker. I'm a worker. You don't have to care for me. It'll be good if you do, but I'm not insisting on it because I'm going to preach the gospel no matter what. I'm going to do it without charge. You see, Paul illustrates the personal rights and the proper execution of those things, and he shows that there needs to be a proper motivation. 1 Corinthians 9, verses 13 and 14 say this as we lead into chapter 9, verse 15 for our message today. Do ye not know that they which minister about holy things live of the things of the temple, and they which wait at the altar are partakers with the altar? Do you not know, church at Corinth, who is doing the work of the Lord, that they have been called by God to minister? They're carrying out their things. Verse number 14, and he reemphasizes by this statement, even so hath the Lord ordained that they which preach the gospel should live of the gospel. That's a good prelude to where we're at today. That's your little bit of review of honor through support. He wants the church to be in a place where they understand that financial compensation and taking care of the leader of the church and the leaders is proper. But he's going to say, hey, I'm going to show you in the second half of this chapter through love never fails, which is his thing, his statement, love never fails. I'm going to give up that. I'm going to forfeit that. I'm going to surrender what you have aligned to do what's right because I'm compelled to do so. But please do not discount God's anointing, God's calling out, on the leader of the church and who they're supposed to be. You see, Paul was, if not the greatest, pretty close to it. I can't find anybody else. Timothy might be a good second. But Paul is a great example of a man who shepherded, of made disciples. He taught, he preached, he planted churches, he won people to Christ. The fruit to his account is immense. He was a man that went after the crowns that will be found at the judgment seat of Christ, and he referred to them in his writings. His statement basically in his life, one of them came down to this: I am willing to forsake all that I have and all that I am. Thus the title for today, willing to forsake all. Are you willing to forsake all? In fact, let me just grab this and then we'll read the passage. When it comes to the gospel that saved you, born again Christian today, child of God, you know. These things have I written to you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe in the name of the Son of God. That's what the scriptures say in 1 John. The Bible also says, but for as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. So, I've called on the name of the Lord to save me. I believe in the Lord as my Savior. I turn from my life and I turn to his. I put my trust in the blessed hope of the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, which is what we sung about today, the gospel in its pure form. So, with that being said, are you willing to forsake all that you have, all that you are, simply for the gospel? That's what Paul is saying to the church. I am willing to forsake all. Well, I'm not Paul the Apostle. I'm just, you know, whatever. Paul called himself the chief of sinners, the least of the apostles. He is no better to the Lord in terms of his estimation than you. He is who he is. He is a man who said, hey, of the tribe of Benjamin, circumcised eighth day, Gamaliel, Pharisee of Pharisees, I'm everything and I count that but dung, I count that all but loss, the excellency of Christ, that's all I want to know, so I forsake all that I am. Will you? Have you? And I ask you, if you're lost today, you never called on the name of the Lord to save you, you've never believed in the Lord Jesus Christ and him alone, put your faith and your trust in him to forgive you, and that all that he did is all that I need, because there's nothing I can do, that I learned by the Bible's statement, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves, it's the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. If you've never done that, then maybe today you're willing to forsake your lost life and all your sin to call in the name of the Lord to save you. When you see that word forsake, it means something in a negative, but we're willing to forsake all of ourselves. What does it mean in the positive context? To forsake means to leave behind, to let loose, to depart from, and to abandon. Hebrews 13:5, a verse that some of you would be very familiar, let your conversation be without covetousness and be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. Very simply, when you desert yourself, when you leave behind self, when you leave that hopelessness behind of you and you put your faith and trust in the Lord, then you're saying, God, I'm willing to forsake all for the gospel. I don't need any monies for it. I don't need to have a bat in the back. I don't need to have anything other than to please you, because you are worthy. Jesus Christ said from the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That means that he is speaking to the God of the universe as he is God, saying, why hast thou forsaken me? My God, my God. Jesus Christ sensed the negative side of that forsaking as God allowed him, his Father, to take on the sin of the world. And Jesus felt that forsakening. Today we turn it to a good side and saying, I'm willing to forsake and abandon all that would get in the way of me saying, yes, Lord, the gospel's paramount to me, just like Paul, just like, of course, the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter number 9, join me in verse number 15. It'll be up on the screen as always. I'm going to read through it, and I have three simple little things in our lesson today. But I have used none of these things, Paul says, neither have I written these things that it should be so done unto me. For it were better for me to die than that any man should make my glorying void. For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of. He's saying, I don't glory in and of myself, the glory belongs to God. He's saying very simply this, for necessity is laid upon me, yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. For if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. But if against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. What is thy reward then? Verily that, when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. For though I be free from all men, yet have I made myself servant unto all, that I might gain the more. And unto the Jews I became as a Jew, that I might gain the Jews. To them that are under the law as under the law, that I might gain them that are under the law. Verse 21, to them that are without law, as without law, being not without law, to God, but under the law to Christ, that I might gain them that are without law. Okay, so he's got a lot. That's a mouthful right there. He says, I also too, to the weak became I as weak, that I might gain the weak. I am made all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now here's the big finish. And this I do for the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize, so run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. The corruptible crown goes to one person, the winner of a race on this earth. The incorruptible crown goes to all of you that say, hey, I'm going to endure the hardness as a good soldier. I am going to live my life according to the Lord Jesus Christ. It says in verse 26, I therefore so run, not as uncertainly so fight I, not as one that beateth the air, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. Now, Father, thank you for the reading of your scripture in the name of Jesus. It is the living word of God. Thank you for the Holy Spirit's teaching power and office as teacher. I pray for the body of Christ. I pray for First Bible Baptist Church, my brothers and sisters in the Lord, that we would truly find from you what you have for each and every one of us, personally and collectively and corporately as a church. I thank you for already having a blessed time this morning, and we want to finish strong on our gathering today as we, on the first day of the week, celebrate you, dear Jesus, and your resurrection. Again, God, have your way. Direct us and lead us in the places we need to go. You do the teaching. We give you the honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That title up there, again, hits pretty strong, willing to forsake all. You say, well, Paul the Apostle, in his writing, is speaking to the person that's called out, the pastor teacher, the shepherd. He's also speaking to the whole idea of this apostle that started the church, and he is the church planter. But it also comes to us personally. So historically and doctrinally, when you put the setting in this church at Corinth, who has had a few messes that they have worked through because of their twisting and perverting of doctrine, of their fake or lazy view on sin, of not seeing the importance of holiness, of perverting the Lord's Supper, spiritual gifts, which we'll get into very soon. And we see at this point right now that Paul's saying, hey, I surrendered all. I'll leave everything behind. Are you willing to do the same? The Holy Spirit speaking to each one of us. He said, hey, in the first part of this chapter, I taught you about your financial responsibility to take care of the ox that treads out the corn. Now I'm going to show you what it means to surrender your personal rights and go further than that because of the gospel. And that can apply, obviously, hey, it's just for you, pastor, and it's just for those pastor people, but it applies to each and every one of us. Are we willing to forsake all? God has shown me three simple little things in our message this morning, a little bit of a breakdown as part of our lesson, and as always, I like to break it down, of course, with parts of the scripture. So, the first one I have for you up on the screen, tying together to the title, we forsake, or forsake all for the gospel. So God's man is going to say this, just an approach, I'm willing to refuse financial compensation. Paul said this. Paul said, hey, now that you got everything right in the way that you ought to be able to in your motivations, have perspective on how to treat me as the Apostle Paul, as the ministers of the gospel. I want you to know that as God's man, I'm not in need of this financial compensation, though I am very, very thankful that now you see the need. In fact, what he's trying to get across is this. My willingness ought to be everyone's willingness. Well, you say, well, I don't get paid to share the gospel, but is it possible that some of us share the gospel and do it in a way where we want others to pay attention to us? Maybe we want a pat on the back. Maybe we want acknowledgement. Maybe we want someone to see that we signed up and we said that we would do that thing. Well, you know that more people would just go door knocking, then more people would get saved, but you're not going. Or you did, so you're better than me. And whoa, 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 time out. Paul's saying that as God's man, and this is the way we ought to approach it, I'm willing to refuse financial compensation, Paul specifically, but I need to look at this thing as the scriptures say. It says in verse number 16, for though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of, for necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. He's simply saying, look, I'm not glorying it. The glory is unto the Lord. I'm going to preach the gospel. It's of a necessity to me. Don't get all mixed up here, and that the only reason I'm doing it is because I get money. Now, there are people that do that. In fact, in this world that you live in, one of the things that turns people off that are not in church culture, they're not born again, or they've gone to a church, maybe they got saved, maybe they stopped going to church, is the issue of money. They see the church charging the gospel and asking for a return. He's saying, again, in verse number 18, what is my reward then? Verily that when I preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge. That means it's free. And when I preach it, it's free. And it's when it comes across, it's without charge, which means there's no expense tied to it. It doesn't require any outlay. Well, we need to get the best preacher, the best teacher, the best everything, and we're going to give them a big honorarium, a big, huge invoice is going to come, and then you'll get the best speakers. That's an abuse of the gospel. Paul's saying, I don't need anything. I'm not glorying in any one thing. I'm not saying that this is my job. There's nothing that makes this my job. And I'm not charging anything. He's saying very simply that, hey, the man that I am in the Lord is enough. Let's just put it this way. It was completely unexpected that Paul would want to be acknowledged, recognized, or given remuneration for the pure joy he relished in proclaiming the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Wouldn't you agree with that? It's not even that difficult to acknowledge that. It's, in fact, completely unexpected that Paul would know. He was saying, he very simply is this. He would want never to be acknowledged. He would want never to be recognized, and he would not want anything in return for proclaiming the gospel. He knew it was of a divine stewardship, the dispensation of the gospel laid upon him. He is the preacher of the gospel in the age of the church, in the age of grace. Turn with me in 1 Timothy chapter number 6. I've been teaching a little bit through the five T's, just finished up a few weeks ago, so you'll see some familiarity if you were in that course. But here's some great teaching by Paul to Timothy. Now consider this in that statement. It was completely unexpected that Paul would want to be. I mean, it's like, okay, Paul. Well, what did Paul tell Timothy? 1 Timothy chapter number 6 about this money thing. Verse number 6 says, but godliness with contentment is great gain. You with me? Verse number 7, 1 Timothy 6. For we brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. I see this content thing here quite a bit. Verse number 9. Let me read this really slowly. Let's let it sink in by the Spirit of God. Now consider this. Money is not a neutral thing. But money is not the bad thing. It's the love of it. Verse 9 says, but they that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare. So those that are rich will fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Think of what that scripture is saying and tying together to verse number 10. For the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith, pierced themselves through with many sorrows. Like oftentimes in Scripture, Paul is giving a warning to Timothy. The Holy Spirit is giving a warning to all of us. And what we are being told is, hey, are you willing, and forsaking all for the gospel, to refuse any type of compensation from the Lord that would be something trapped to this earth? Whatever reward is in heaven and in glory, because the love of money is the root of all evil. It doesn't say that the money. It says the love of it. And verse number 9 is very, very clear. They that will be rich fall into temptation and a snare, which means when we are rich, we can fall in, very simply, to a temptation and a snare. We are subjected to the idea that we would make foolish decisions. We would be stuck with our hurtful lusts, and which would drown men in destruction and perdition. Having the money is one thing. Having the love of it. Paul's saying, I don't even want to come close to it. Paul's telling Timothy, that's how important it is. As you walk through the whole chapter of chapter number 6, so much is about it. Even in verse number 11, but thou, O man of God, flee these things. Follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience. You go through the whole thing. Fight the good fight of fight. Lay hold on eternal life. Paul is warning his pastor-trained son in the Lord, his brother and fellow soldier, hey, watch out. Watch out for the final financial compensation, because godliness with contentment is great gain. Again, when we look at forsaking all, willing to forsake all for the gospel, Paul is teaching us something here. Secondly, forsake all for the gospel. God's man says, I'm willing to deny self to declare hope to the lost. Go back to 1 Corinthians chapter number 9. I'll come back to 2 Timothy here in a moment. Forsake all for the gospel. So what does God's man say? What does God's girl say? What does a God person say? I'm willing to deny self. First off, I'm willing to refuse, not even take any financial compensation. Paul's also saying, hey, I've got to deny self to declare hope to the lost. This man loved the idea that he could get the gospel to anyone that was lost. He would deny himself. How often are we willing to deny ourselves? Paul was willing to modify his whole lifestyle, his habits, what he liked to do, his preferences, so that he could never be in a position where he wasn't willing to come as far down as a little child and bring the gospel to a child so they could understand it. Paul was willing to adopt whatever situation and adapt himself to it for the gospel to go out. Look in 1 Corinthians again, chapter number 9. He says, Jews, I became a Jew that I might gain the Jews. Those under the law, that I might gain that are under the law. Verse 21, to them that are without the law, as without the law. And he's saying, I will do that without financial compensation. You don't have to pay me extra to bring me in to preach the gospel so a bunch of people get saved, so then you can say, hey, you did a great job. Paul's saying, I'm willing to deny myself to declare hope to the lost. I will go to any city that God leads me to. When God shuts a door, I'll go where he tells me to go. I'll go with the churches of Macedonia. I'll go to the churches of Asia. I'll go wherever he tells me to go. But what I need to do is realize that I'm willing up front to deny myself, deny my preferences, my pleasures. Verse 22 says, to the weak became I as weak that I might gain the weak. I made all things to all men. Verse 23, and this I do for what? For the gospel's sake, that I might be partaker thereof with you. Maybe if I put it this way. It is not complicated to deduce that Paul was completely surrendered to the calling and commission of God. It's not that hard. It's not complicated to figure that out. Beyond his surrendered heart, though, burned an unquenchable love for the lost sinner. That means you have to forsake all. Make some adjustments in you. I need to make some adjustments in me. My personal preferences need to take a back seat for the gospel. He had a surrender to the commission and calling of the gospel that burned in him an unquenchable love for the lost sinner. Is he the only one? Is he supposed to be the only one? Is the pastor the only, is he supposed to just stand up and tell you all this and then we don't do anything about it? As the Holy Spirit is telling you, believer, there's people that need to hear the gospel. There's people that need to know the hope of Jesus Christ. There's people that are sinners that need grace, mercy. Paul said, hey, I'm free from all men, yet I'm servant to all men. Kind of a little bit of a twist on things. I'm your servant for Jesus Christ's sake. He was free. He wasn't beholden. Go to 2 Timothy chapter number 1. He was only beholden to the Lord Jesus Christ, but he sensed and complete responsibility, accountability to all those that were lost. And he said, I am willing. I am willing to be what he wants me to be, to deny myself, to declare hope to the lost. And 2 Timothy chapter number 1, it says in verse number 8, you're familiar with this passage from a few years back in the Acts 1:8 conference. It behooves us repeating and rereading it to really let it sit and sink home. Verse number 8 says, but Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began, but is now made manifest by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who hath abolished death and has brought life and immortality to light through the gospel, whereunto I am appointed preacher, apostle, teacher of the Gentiles. He go to the centerpiece of every city where the temple is, looking for someone who's lost. If the Jews kicked him out, then he said, I'll go to the Gentiles. That's my assignment anyway. But he always went to his brethren in Israel just to see if there was one lost. He says in verse number 12, for the which cause I also suffer these things. Nevertheless, I'm not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed. And I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Whoo, what a powerful statement by Paul to Timothy as he exhorts Timothy and he lifts him up and he says, don't be ashamed of your testimony of the Lord and don't be ashamed of me as a prisoner. Deny self. Understand the true meaning of 1 Corinthians 9. It's not that I can go and sin like the sinners so that I can kind of have a good time with the sinners while I might give them the gospel. That's not what it says. It's going into the sinner's life with the gospel of hope, the hope of Jesus Christ for the person that is lost and in need of the Savior. Lastly, forsake all for the gospel. Our third one of our lesson. God's man says this also. He says, I'm willing to deny self. I'm willing not to take any financial compensation. And now God's man says, I'm willing to subject myself to the life of Christ. Go back to 1 Corinthians 9. And then we'll be back at 2 Timothy 2 to finish. What does it mean to subject yourself? You know what the meaning of subject is? To bring under the power or dominion of. To put under or within the power of. It says here in verse 27, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection. I subject my body and my life to Jesus Christ. So here we go. Let's just make it real serious here as we finish. Paul is saying something that is really out of bounds to the normal mind of the human frailty. But it's what we need to hear. I need to hear it. I need to hear that I'm so drawn and such a propensity to please myself that subjecting myself to the life of Christ, Christ suffered. Christ was rejected. Christ was spit on. Christ was mocked. And I'm supposed to be willing to subject myself to the life of Christ. How is it that I want to always come up a little short on that? Yes, I'll do a little self-denial so that I can give somebody the gospel. But Paul's saying very strongly in verse number 24, 25, 26, and 27, subject yourself as I have. Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize, so run that ye may obtain. What are you going to obtain? The prize in the Lord Jesus Christ. Verse 25, and every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible, a crown that will die off and burn. But we do it for an incorruptible crown, the incorruptible crown of living for the Lord Jesus Christ and being a witness. He says, I therefore so run, not as uncertainly, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air. I'm not wasting my time. Like a lot of people waste their time on trying to win a race that doesn't matter a thing. Some of you are wasting your time because you don't want to tie yourself to the life of Christ because it's going to be so hard. Well, how easy is it to subject yourself to this world or your own flesh. I know what it's like for me when I subject myself to the life of this world and the life of Mark Brown. I'm a miserable cuss. But when I submit myself to the life of Christ and go through the sufferings of this life and the trials and the testings, it is hallelujah all the time in the midst of my grief and my sorrow and my heartache and my loss. It's always okay when I submit myself and subject myself to the life of Christ. Every single time, he's never let me down. God himself has never failed you. My daughter sent me a text the other day as we were weeping, and she said, God did not fail. And I said, you're right. We may fail. We may fall, but he will never fail, and he'll pick you right back up. And the life of Christ will be a life of suffering, but it's going to be okay. Because in Jesus Christ, we will finish the race, and we will get the incorruptible crown. To expose or submit or make yourself accountable. It cannot be overstated how Paul knew the course that the Lord's holy calling put him on. It was serious. The seriousness of the calling on your life, every one of you, say you're not Apostle Paul, you're not supposed to be a pastor. He put a calling on you in the gospel. Go and get after it. It's up to you and me and all of us together, because the realization is that he finished the race and it was paramount to him, and it drove him to self-discipline. We are so sloppy with how we use our time. I am so sloppy with what I do. I need to shore it up and let God work through me both to will and to do of his good pleasure. That's what I meant by that. Go to 2 Timothy chapter number 2. 2 Timothy 2, and I'll finish right here. 2 Timothy 2, everybody is familiar in that discipleship world. There you go, B, I knew you'd find me. And I know this is the discipleship chapter and all, but let me just tell you, Paul's telling Timothy the same stuff he's telling the church at Corinth, telling the church at Thessalonica. Verse number 1, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. You know, a lot of you know that second verse, that. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men, who shall be able to teach others also. Commit these things to faithful men. Well, I want to be a faithful man that God will commit these things to. Not an unfaithful man. He says in verse number 3, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangle himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen to be a soldier. He chose you to be a soldier. He chose every one of us believers to be a soldier, to be a servant, to be a son of God. And if a man also strive for masteries, yet is he not crowned, except he strive lawfully. We need to do it right in the eyes of the Lord. He says the husbandman, the caretaker over that laboreth, must be first a partaker of the fruits. Paul's telling Timothy, this is the way you operate the church at Ephesus, the church that left its first love, Jesus and one another. I don't want that to happen to us. We're to be strong in the grace. We're to commit things to faithful men. We're to teach others also, and we're to endure hardness as a good soldier. When you and I decide, hey, I'm completely willing to subject my life to the life of Christ, it will be the life changer, not a game changer. This isn't a game. Well, he talked about running a race and all that. The race he's running is for the crown in glory. The race he is running is to follow Jesus and finish his course. It's all that's important. You see, Paul's love for the church reflects the same love that Christ has. This is the love that Christ has for you, for our church. He's willing to give his life, and he gave it all. There's no sense in trying to come up short and working really hard on it. It's time to trust in the Lord. It really is. Trust in the Lord one more moment, one more thought, one more day. Trust in him. Trust in him and the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Our invitation and prayer today is this. Have you given your life to the gospel of Jesus Christ? You say, sure, I'm born again, I'm saved. Good. Then you know that you're born again, you're saved today. Have you given your life to the gospel since you got saved? I didn't say get saved all over again. Paul gave his life to the gospel. He said, Lord, Lord, what would thou have me to do? And then he did it until he was martyred, until he was killed, until his life was taken from him. And if you're lost today, maybe you are. You've never called on the name of the Lord to save you. The Bible says very simply, for by grace are you saved through faith, not of yourselves, as the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Believing in the good news of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is believing in the gospel. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Saved from what? From the punishment of your sin and from an eternity apart from God in a godless hell. But the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Maybe today you want to do that. Maybe today it's going to be the day. I pray that you give your life to the gospel. And I pray, church believers, that you would give your life to the gospel in giving it to others. Please bow for a word of prayer and join me as I pray over you and pray for you and then give you a chance to spend some time with the Father in heaven. Father, this is our invitation time in the name of Jesus. This is our time of prayer. And I pray that you will bring a stirring in the hearts of your believers to give their lives, to give the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I pray for those that are lost here today that do not know that they're born again. They've never called out to Jesus and trusted in him completely, that they're still holding on to their own belief system. I pray that this would be the day that they would call on the name of the Lord, that you would bring them forward, that you would, God, stir in their hearts truly to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. God, have your way in this time of invitation in Jesus' name. Please stand.